This is a rare opportunity for me. I talk a lot. In fact, one of my problems is I probably talk too much. But when someone's pointing a camera at you, and it's kind of a different ballgame I'm finding out here. But first of all, I'd like to thank Carol Wells and Joyce Hennis, and for sure Boyd, for encouraging me to do this, and of course Donna Korth, who invited me. And that's the reason I'm sitting right here right now, is to talk a little bit about one of the great joys and passions of my life, wilderness canoeing. Now, that might not sound like a apropos subject as we're sitting here in a sanctuary, but to me, canoeing in the deep wilderness is actually the most spiritual thing that I do. And towards the end here, I want to read a small paragraph from Orion, who's certainly one of my mentors. And I know that he's with me when I'm out there because he said so. And he's been with every mountaineer and every person who's been spent time in the wilds. And what I mean by the wilds is the deep wilds. Like where man seldom goes or never goes, that's where I like to go. And so I'd like to start it out a little bit by going back 40 years. When I was doing all the wild, crazy stuff with the motorcycles and so forth, I rode with my brother. We put my motorcycle in his van and went down to Florida from Seattle to his big sailboat. And I spent a couple months with him down there, and then I decided to ride my motorcycle back 4,000 miles to Seattle. And it's not a big deal for some people, but for me, who is basically a pretty inept fellow when it comes to mechanics, it was a monumental challenge to ride my bike 4,000 miles in the wintertime. And so I took off anyway. But interesting enough, after I got out there about 700-800,000 miles, I started feeling like somebody was riding with me, if you will. Somebody, it was like I was having heavenly help. And that encouraged me very much. I remember one little ritual I had. I had this beautiful bike. It was a candy apple red, but it had a chrome gas cap. And I remember every time I had a negative thought about what could happen or what might happen and so forth like that, I caught myself and I found myself shining, apologizing to the bike and shining this chrome gas cap. Well, anyway, after about 1,000 miles or so, I got over into New Mexico and Arizona, and I basically knew that someone was looking out for me, that I had heavenly helpers. And so, encouraged by that and reinforced, I said, well, hey, if I can do this with my heavenly helpers, what would I really want to do that when I got there, I would be totally happy? And after some more miles, I came up with the idea that I'd like to be a wildlife photographer in Alaska. Now, that might sound like a pretty off-the-wall destination for some people, but at that particular time, I was in Washington. I was a member of the Washington Trailblazers, who used to backpack fish in the high mountain lakes and had been doing it since the 20s. And they take in one member a year, and I was their member in 1958. And then I worked a couple of summers for the Forest Service as a trail foreman. And I belonged to the Seattle Mountaineers, and I was even a Boy Scout when I was a young guy. So I had all the prerequisites, and I was definitely into photography. I bought my first camera in Japan while I was an oiler on a submarine in 1954. And so I had all the basic prerequisites, except I was mostly in Washington. And when you get into wilderness, Washington and even Montana are like high school. But if you want your PhDs, you go to Alaska. Alaska's and northern Canada is where the really wild places are. So anyway, when I got back, I ended up selling my bike. And interesting, while I was riding my bike one day, I hadn't found a canoe. I'd been looking all over for it. But one day I'm riding my bike out in the country, and all of a sudden this inspiration, Bluefeather, just came out of the wilds, just came out of the blue. And I said, wow, there's a great name for my canoe when I get it. So that's how the Bluefeather came to be there. So I'll make it a little bit faster here. But just like if you go out and buy a baseball bat and a ball and a glove, that doesn't make you a baseball player. So you can go buy a canoe, and even though it was a beautiful 15-foot cedar and a state-of-the-art craft, it's like it doesn't make you a canoeist. And so through trial and error, I spent that summer, I did a lot of canoeing by myself and read some books on it like that. But I felt confident enough that in February of 1974, I had sold everything I owned and got on the ferry to Alaska, the Malaspina, and ended up with my canoe paddling in one of the headwaters of the Yukon River, Tagish Lake. And so what I'd like to do now is I'd like to fast forward about 38 years to the last two summers where I have been paddling in Atlin Lake, British Columbia. It's the largest natural lake in British Columbia. It's up to 4 miles wide and 85 miles long. And the whole southern end is provincial park. It's up in the glaciers and absolutely, totally wild. Drink water right out of the lake without even a thought about it. But the idea is it's totally wild. Totally wild. I could go for a week without even hearing a human sound and then maybe hear a float plane go over maybe 5 miles down the lake or something. But the thing I liked about it was, especially if you're on a spiritual venture or mission, is that it seems like you're on introspection mode the whole time. Every time you have a thought when you're out in the wilds like that, it's like it's on a reader board. And if you're out there trying to purify your thoughts, it must have been like the old dictations for Godfrey and Lotus there, where they basically were flashed on the wall there and they could read these. But that's the way your thoughts are when you're out there like that. And so when you're out in the deep wilds like that, the only imperfect thing out there was me. All my gear, all my equipment, my canoe, everything, my experience, everything was perfect. The only imperfect thing was me. And so, like, if you're a B student and you want to be an A student, you hang around with A students. And so when I'm out there like that, it's just a matter of time till my imperfect self comes into alignment with the perfection of the wilderness. And being out there is not an easy thing. I call it the man on the street. The man on the street to be canoeing for 3, 4, 6 weeks in the wilds by yourself is no easy accomplishment. You have to do, just like to be a good professional baseball player, you don't just buy a ball and a bat. You got to spend a lot of time at it. And so I feel that I have spent a lot of time at it. I just turned 80 years old here a month or so ago, and I probably got 70 years of that in the wilds. And so I've perfected my skills to a high degree, and I feel like I can go out with anybody. And my wife is all kind of nervous because I'm planning on going out and doing another solo adventure in Canada this year. and figures I'm 80 years old, but I'm not any ordinary 80-year-old guy. And so I've known that for a long time. And so I want to go out there and do this while I still can. But it's the closest way that I can get to God Almighty. And when you're out there in the wilds, it's like it's you and God. There's nobody else. You eliminate the middleman, if you will. There's just you and Creator. And when you're out there for 2 weeks, 3 weeks, a month and a half by yourself, it would be very hard to explain the oneness that you feel and the oneness that you become. And I have a saying that always kind of makes people laugh a little bit. It's like my gear is like I'm sitting here right now. I could put on a pair of snowshoes and go out in the wild and be perfectly compatible with the elementals. Being color coordinated in the wilderness is a big deal for me. And everything I got, even my pens that I write in my journals, are green ink. And one that I like to say is I have a green toothbrush, a green toothbrush holder, and even green toothpaste. And I have a saying that says, you can tell a real wilderness guy by looking at the color of his toothpaste. And so you probably won't find that in any wilderness books or anything like that. But being color coordinated in the wilderness is just as big a deal as actually being there. It's like being where the elementals just take you by the hand and say, hey, man, this guy's okay. This guy's done his homework, you know. And the feeling that you have when you're out there canoeing alone is like unlike any feeling I've ever had in my whole life. Listening to David do these decrees this morning, I'm sure he was in a zone doing those decrees like, you know, I can only dream about being in. And that's the way I feel when I'm in the wild country, too. I'm in a place I'm so privileged and honored. I am so happy to be John Bluefeather. And I know that now I'm into my computer and into my photography. I know that if there isn't something that I don't like, I can just delete it. And I've known that even though I haven't always been the most model citizen, that I've been in so much pure and wonderful and wild wilderness that God can just delete that, can delete the stuff that isn't pure and wonderful. And so I have a high regard for myself, not in an egoic way, but in the fact that I know that I'm totally blessed. And I'd just like to share part of the aspect of being out there is like when you're in bear country, heavy duty bear country. In fact, last night I just watched an amazing film on the Chamkatka bears, the Siberian brown bears. When you're in heavy duty brown bear country, you have to have a certain mindset. And I equate it to like walking into the sanctuary. You don't just walk into this sanctuary thinking mundane thoughts and so forth. You focus yourself. And when you're in a wilderness, you have to do the same thing. It's like, and you have to present, when you're in brown bear country, you have to present an image to that bear. You can't be walking around in bear country like a dog with his tail between his legs. You have to have a certain amount of equanimity and poise. And so knowing the best bear medicine is a pure heart. I call it bear consciousness. The same energy that made the bear made me. And so if I'm at peace with that essence, then basically I don't feel like I have any bear problems. Now we know that the best bear medicine is a pure heart. But I'd also like to add the second best is a 45-70. with 540 grain hammerheads in it. That's for my little quaking ego self out there until I can get and stay into my Christ consciousness. When you're in bear country, it almost forces you to be into Christ consciousness because you have to be at one with the universe, basically. And it also works for mosquitoes, which is a big deal, too. And so I remember my life changed dramatically when I was on a mountain in Alaska many years ago. And I had the thought that come down. I used to go up there and always come down with like Moses with these tablets. And I remember one time, one of my best ones was, the winners are singing and dancing, and the losers are crying and moaning. I remember that a lot. I mean, when I get kind of down to myself, I said, hey, are you crying and moaning or are you singing and dancing? But the one that really changed my mind prominently was, there'll be no killing on my holy mountain. And that was 25, 30 years ago, and I haven't hunted since. And that has changed dramatically my life to try to get into the spirit of ahimsa, harmlessness towards life. That's a big deal when you're in the wilderness to have the feeling of harmlessness towards life. It's like the elementals jump on you and they just play with you. It's like they can trust you. They can trust you. And like I like to say, like noise is to silence, killing is to love. And I don't want to be controversial here, but if you can even pull down and put your sights on deer and pull the trigger in the name of feeding my family and stuff, that's an old outmoded mode, just like cassettes and 8-tracks. There's a supermarket on every corner, so killing. The feeling of when the Bible says, when the commandments are, thou shalt not kill, it didn't say thou shalt not just kill humans. It said thou shalt not kill. And so, to me, that's a major, major point when you're in the wilderness, is to have that mindset where You're one with everything. And it's just like, can you imagine somebody coming into your house or your yard with a gun bent on killing? Well, that's the same thing. If you're going out in the wilderness, you got the same thing. You know, everybody likes the people that are respectful, kind, courteous. And the wilderness is the same thing. The elementals like it when you are kind, courteous, and respectful. And so I don't know how my 15 minutes is going here, but I'm kind of
seem like pretty important lessons to me, and I appreciate everything you've said.
There's no better way to me to be into the wilderness and what I like to call the deep wilderness. It's just like there's meditation and then there's deep meditation. It's just like there's a sandlot baseball and then there's Major League Baseball. Well, there's canoeing out here at Daly Lake or what have you, but then there's canoeing what I like to call the deep wilderness. That's way back in there where nobody goes, nobody. Very seldom do I ever see anybody in the backcountry, and that's the way I like it. And I very seldom take people with me. When I was a guide in Alaska, I did it, but sometimes I didn't really care for it because the people were totally out of tune. They didn't know what they were doing. And so I enjoy being by myself in the deep wilderness. And there's no better way to get there than to be in a canoe. Also, before I forget about it, I'd like to give out my email address, jbluefeather@hotmail.com. And anybody who would send me an email, I would be happy to send them along some pictures of my canoe and a few adventure and animal shots like that to let them know that I'm not really a Johnny come lately in this wilderness stuff here. So I'd like to actually close here, if I can, here with a short paragraph recorded through David on March 19th, 2013. And Orion, who's he's one of my mentors. He's one of the people in God Tabor. God Tabor and Orion, when you're out in the... In fact, the two books that I had with me when I was out there was the I Am Discourses books, Gods of the Mountains, and the beloved book on Jesus, 18 Calls of Jesus in the Footsteps of the Masters. And also I had a third book, too, The Life and Teachings of the Masters of the Far East, Book 5. And also I need to mention about journal keeping. There's no way that you can go out, there's no way that I can go out for a month by myself in the wilds and never make contact with humans without a journal. The journal becomes your best friend. I mean, I write things in my journal that even the closest people to me haven't a clue about. And it's like, it gives you someone to talk to. It gives you someone to reflect to and to record your thoughts. And then, when I get done writing a paragraph or two or a page, I go back and read what I just read, what I just wrote. And so that lets me know where I'm at. So anyway, I could keep nibbling away here and going on and on, but I'd like to finish this off and thank you for your patience with my friend, beloved Orion. There is something about the eternal silence that enters your heart when you are within nature's secret places. For there God is not involved in the up and downs in the duality of human creations. For in the comfort of silence, there is a quickening of divine mindfulness and an opening of new valves of spirit within, for you to obtain that which is divine and virtuous, beautiful and noble. I hardly urge everybody to get out into a canoe and to realize that it's a vehicle of the spirit. The masters are always talking about the silence, the deep silence, and there is no more silent way to enter the deep wilderness than through a canoe. God bless you, and thank you very much.